Hi guys, it's me, Dr. Smina Ramon, gyno girl. I'm coming to you from our procedure room in my office in Fulton Market. Today I wanted to speak to you about something that I see on a daily basis as a specialist in sex med and perimenopause and menopause, and that is relating to vulvar itching. So we're going to talk about some top reasons that patients come in for vulvar itching, but also we're going to get into a little bit about lichen sclerosus, which is one of the conditions that I treat pretty readily and consistently in my office. And let's get at it. Hey guys, okay, it's me, Dr. Smina Ramon, gyno girl. I'm here in my procedure room where I do some hysteroscopy and some procedures under anesthesia, but also where my husband, who does interventional pain, he does most of his fluoroscopic procedures here. Anyway, so today I was going to talk to you about a condition I see pretty routinely in my office, vulvar itching. So it's the itch you can't scratch, but we usually do try to scratch when it's itching. And so let's talk about some of that and some of the reasons that we experience these conditions. I'll look at my cute little scrunchie that my office staff gave me. At your cervix. Isn't that cute? Okay. Anyway, okay, so again, I'm Dr. Smina Ramon, gyno girl. I am a board certified gynecologist. I've been in my own private practice for about 9 years now, and I specialize in sexual medicine. I'm a fellow and on the board of the International Society for the Study of Women's Sexual Health, ISHWISH. I'm a certified menopause physician with the Menopause Society, formerly known as the North American Menopause Society. I work with International Pelvic Pain Society, IPPS, and ISSBD, as well as the SMSNA, which is the Sexual Medicine Society of North America, and ISSM, the International Society for Sexual Medicine. But I also see conditions related to the vulva all the time, and one of the biggest reasons people come to my office, other than of course vaginal discharge, is vulvar itching or vaginal itching or itching down there or that kind of thing. And you know, the first thing people think of when you think about vaginal itching or vulvar itching is that it must be yeast. And the majority of the time, you know, we are ruling out infection, and we should rule out infection. But in my office, that's not the main reason that I see patients for this condition. I'm going to tell you about vulvar dermatology and some of the stuff that I treat in my office as a vulvar pain specialist as well. So let's talk about it. So first of all, you know, we all think, oh my God, something's uncomfortable down there. What's happening to me? And so the first thing we always think about is it must be a yeast infection, and sometimes you'll get the big white clumpy discharge and some redness down there or swelling. And maybe you'll try over-the-counter fluconazole or clotrimazole, one of those. Please do not use the one-day over-the-counter. I've never had a patient with success with that, even though it's very potent. It irritates the hell out of people. Anyway, so maybe you'll go over-the-counter and you pick up, you know, your monistat 3-day, monistat 7-day, whatever it is. It's not helping. Oh my God, you know, my PCP told me just they prescribed me Diflucan. Maybe they examined, maybe they didn't, but sometimes the symptoms seem so consistent with yeast that, you know, those clinicians that are not, who don't focus on this area as much, and those clinicians who don't focus on this as much, you know, may not be able to pick up on some of the nuances that I see. So, fine, you go through the yeast thing, it doesn't work, you know, you come back, vulva's angry as hell, it's red, it's inflamed. You start scratching, itching at night. You can't get under control. What's happening to me? Ah. So that's when I see patients. I mean, of course, sometimes I'll just pick up on the yeast infections in the office and stuff like that. For a patient that never has had a yeast infection, it's very distressing. Sometimes you get symptoms of urinary tract infections, you know, where you feel like it burns when you pee. You might have that thought, that classic cottage cheese discharge. I hate to describe it as that, but yes. And you'll never think of cottage cheese the same way as a gynecologist. Anyway, so that's what we see, and say that's not the case for you. But now you've irritated your vulva. Now you're having itching. Maybe there is an irritant, you know, that you had predisposed yourself to. So one of the big things that I often see is patients, and one of probably the most common reasons for vulvar itching is really like a dermatitis. You know, you're using pads or using some sort of underwear that's, you know, not cotton and maybe a little irritating. Maybe you're using, you know, toilet paper that doesn't work for you, or tampons or whatever. And so I had a patient that actually, you know, had this strange sort of right-sided vulvar, you know, itching. And well, I'll tell you the diagnosis in a minute, but it turns out that her dermatitis was secondary to, she did pole dancing as like recreational things, like she did for exercise, and she always danced on that one side, and that was probably her irritant. So, you know, our vulvas are sensitive, just like any other part of your skin, you can have some sensitivity. And what happens is over time, you might get more allergic to something, or get like an allergic reaction or a dermatologic reaction to something that's irritating your skin. And so what happens then is that we end up feeling like, this is so irritating, what should I do? And then so people will inadvertently scratch. And what's kind of classic is you might scratch more at night because, you know, you're not as busy during the day, you're settled, you're wearing, you're airing out your clothes, and now you're like, ah, this is very uncomfortable. Or you're sleeping and you don't realize, but your partner certainly does, that you're just going away, scratching away at night. Because when I see you, it'll be a very excoriated vulva. You might have all these other redness, thickening of the skin. So basically, you end up, what happens is you start scratching, you itch, you scratch, you itch, you scratch, you itch, you scratch. We call it the itch scratch cycle, and that results in your skin changing a little bit. It becomes lichenoid, which is like a thickening of the skin, a scaliness to it, and it's lichen simplex chronicus is the fancy word for it. And so what we have to do is then identify what agent was causing the allergic reaction, try to avoid that. You know, I have a set of instructions about vulvar hygiene that I always give my patients so that we can eliminate things. You know, let's not use the things that are out there on the market that are telling you that your vagina and vulva can smell like, you know, flowers or roses. And now all of a sudden I see this patient who's using, you know, one of the Kardashian or Gwyneth Paltrow approved products, and I'm seeing her with this whole inflammatory skin condition now, vulvar dermatitis. So please avoid those products. I did a video on this a couple years ago about how predatory the whole feminine hygiene market is, and it causes a lot of problems, and I see all of them. So that's why I'm so emphatic about it's a multi-million or billion-dollar industry, actually, preying on women to think that we have, you know, smelly, you know, unsightly vulvas. And so, you know, young patients and older patients and all patients are getting insecure about it, and they just, you know, basically use all these products, and then I see them with lichen simplex chronicus or some sort of dermatitis that causes a lot of problems, or, you know, an infection. So that's one thing. We usually use some mid-potency steroids. We have to watch out for super infection of yeast. So sometimes we use a mid-potency steroid plus a yeast medication. We try to identify the allergic agent. If you have anxiety, we try to kind of calm that down, because that just, you know, all these conditions, especially when they become chronic, actually do prey on, you know, those with anxiety, and basically, you know, things can get accelerated, you know, and so we want to watch out for that. And so that's lichen simplex chronicus. Remember, infection is what people think of the most, which is the yeast infections of the world. And then I'll see the dermatologic skin conditions. And then the one that I see quite often also, which I'm only going to get into these two, we're going to do another segment on, you know, lichen planus and some of the others, but lichen sclerosus is sort of a skin condition of the vulva that is not given enough attention to. And for those of us that see it pretty routinely, I see it multiple times a week, you can usually spot it, you know, with the way it looks. Like, here's some pictures of various patients with lichen sclerosus. You can see that there become some of the skin changes that happen, hypopigmented areas, so it looks like white patches. You can get sort of like a cigarette paper looking things. You can get, you know, women of color might present differently, so it's really important to see someone who is savvy with all skin types. And, you know, you can get this perineal fissuring in the middle. So when you have sex, sometimes painful sex can be a cause of, or can result secondary to lichen sclerosus. So that's why sometimes I'll see patients who can't have intercourse because they fissure in the middle. And so that perineal fissuring is kind of a telltale sign. You can also get that with yeast infections, but that's kind of transient. The thickening of the skin, the architecture of the vulva changes. The labia might look like they're fused. The minora and the majora, the clitoris can shrink away and become phimose. And I did a section on clitoral, what's happening with the clitoris, so clitoral phimosis, where the hood just won't come up. You might not even see the body. That's just what happens. And so what is it? It's an inflammatory skin condition. It's chronic, it's inflammation, and it is pretty lifelong. Most people, there are ebbs and flows with any of these chronic inflammatory skin conditions, and so we know that certain patients, we don't know the exact etiology, but most of us in the world of research and the research that's been done on lichen sclerosus, and remember lichen means sort of like a scaly thickening, sclerosus means a scar. So, you know, what happens is we think that the major inciting factor is autoimmune in nature, which means there's a genetic predisposition like most autoimmune diseases, which we know affect women more than men. So autoimmune essentially means you make a protein in your body and your body sees it as foreign. And so what happens when we have a foreign object or foreign exposure, whether or not it's bacteria, a virus, protease, whatever, what happens? Your body develops an immune response. So it sends immune soldiers to the area of concern, and you get immune proteins. You'll get like your white blood cells that kind of come up in there, and then they have all these secretions, and basically that leads to. And what we think happens if you think about the skin having seven layers, we think that in lichen sclerosus there's a protein at the basement layer, the final layer, and so that's the one that your body's signaling as danger, danger. This is not. You know, for this is not something that your body sees it as foreign and so goes for the attack, right? So autoimmune is that's how it happens. People get autoimmune thyroid conditions. There's all these other autoimmune conditions that particularly affect females. So you have this condition happening, and then the layers above it respond secondarily. You'll get the top layers where you get all the sort of scarring and the thickening of the tissue, and it becomes there's all these different types of collagen that you can get, but the collagen that kind of builds up here is sort of an inflexible collagen. It becomes thickened, and this is what happens. The tissue and the architecture starts to change. And so we think it's autoimmune, which means there's a genetic predisposition, which means at various points in your life, stressors, hormone changes, you know, environmental factors, food you may be eating, like any inflammatory autoimmune condition, you know, that's why people can go into remission and then they get spikes of it. So there's a lot of ebb and flow when it comes to this. Our goal is to get patients in remission where they just need a little steady state medication. But what happens is you have this condition, average age is like 51 for it, but we know it needs to be considered a bimodal distribution, meaning that pre-pubertal girls would get it and post-menopausal. But we know now that in that 20 to 50 age range, I see it all the time. It seems like clinicians weren't looking for it, so we weren't finding it, but I see it all the time, and so do my colleagues that treat lichen sclerosus. And so what ends up happening is we have to do a biopsy, which is a very small procedure in the office. We put a little anesthetic cream and anesthetic injection. We get a 4-millimeter punch biopsy. Get the area that looks most concerning, remove it. I don't usually cauterize biopsies. I'll either put a suture in or hold pressure until it doesn't bleed anymore. Send it to a dermatopathologist and they confirm the diagnosis. They'll see this hypokeratosis, which means, you know, increased keratin, which means, you know, like this tough sort of skin that we know about that we see, and that's how the skin becomes a little bit tougher, becomes thicker, changes colors, and so then we go for treatment. And it kind of just depends on how aggressive it is. Is it just the perineum? Is it all over? Is your clitoris phimose? Do we have to do clitoral lysis of adhesions? Do we have to do a dorsal slit procedure of the clitoris? You know, it depends on what we're dealing with and what your symptoms are and if you're having how much sexual pain and sexual concerns you have. But the mainstay treatment for most patients is a potent steroid. So you know, people say, well, I can't be on steroids all my life. Well, you can if you have Lichen sclerosis, because your skin isn't normal. If you use steroids on normal skin, of course, that's why we biopsy. We also biopsy to make sure there's no cancer. About 4 to 6% of patients with Lichen sclerosis left untreated can get vulvar cancer, which is very alarming. So then we make the diagnosis. This patient's been scratching. Oh, I've been treated for, and the classic is, I've been treated for yeast infections all my life, and I don't know if I've ever had a positive culture, but I'm always scratching down there and it just seems to be normal or whatever the case may be. And then we'll look and be like, wow, architecturally, the labia are fused, the clitoris is phimose, there's hypopigmented patches, you know, there's thickening, there's scaling, all this stuff. And so then we do the biopsy, we confirm, and we start patients on these ultra-potent steroids, clobetasol. And I usually use a form of ointment. You know, there's gels, there's foams. That's usually for thinner skin. For thicker skin, we need to use like creams or ointments. I usually go for ointments. And we need it to penetrate the skin, right? So if you have something really rough or keratinized and thickened, what I always tell patients and what we, most of us in this field say, is that you have to soak the area for like 90 seconds. You know, that's using maybe a Perry bottle. I love bidets for my patients with Lichen sclerosis. So, and I'm just a bidet user myself, so I love bidets. So, we use those to kind of like moisten the area, soften the area, pat dry, don't rub and itch. That, you know, that's the same for Lichen simplex chronicus. You don't want to do all this stuff. So you pat dry and then you start using the medication. You rub it in for like 90 seconds to 100 seconds till you feel like it's penetrated the skin. And usually after, you know, 6 to 12 weeks, you know, you might see some improvement. Depending on how aggressive yours is, you might take 6 months to get into remission. We don't know what other stressors you're under, like, you know, we don't know hormonal status. And so, you know, this is a very common inflammatory skin condition, which you think is autoimmune in nature, Lichen sclerosis. There are many groups that advocate for Lichen sclerosis. And so I'm just gonna list those here. Shout out to all of them. And so that's that on vulvar itching. Just one more thing though, you know, back to the genital urinary syndrome, menopause can also cause a lot of vulvar discomfort and vaginal discomfort. So it's beyond just, you know, vaginal dryness or sexual pain or, you know, urinary urgency frequency. You can get like this feeling of a little discomfort. And so I always like to find out the estrogen status of my patients and whether or not estrogen can be helpful or not. Sometimes, you know, in high estrogen states, symptoms might get worse, but we want to make sure that we're not dealing with a totally deprived estrogen environment too, because you know, we want to make sure that you know, the skin can remodel and try to get to a better place where you're not under so much discomfort, where you might not be getting the urinary tract infections. So the vaginal estrogen again, and vaginal estrogen again is very helpful for that. So, you know, in a perimenopausal or postmenopausal patient with a little vulvar discomfort, vulvar itching, you know, we always look to see if they have any other genital urinary syndrome or menopause, but, you know, 99% of my patients are gonna go home with vaginal estrogen. That's about it for vulvar itching. I'm gonna go into it a little bit more next time with Lichen planus, but in some of the rare conditions that I see in my office. But other than that, I just wanted to give a little blurb about vulvar itching, because we see it so frequently and so many things can cause it. So please like and subscribe to my channel, and more to come, guys. See ya. Bye.